Another day, another mass genocide. I'm Naffy Brian, and I admit it. I orchestrated Squid Game, the whole thing. That guy that was in the show, that was just my spokesman, a representative. I am the real mastermind. Actually, no, never mind. They stole my idea. They took it without permission. The first Squid Game type game was, you guessed it, Minecraft Shorts. That's where the real stakes are. On a conceptual and philosophical level, Minecraft Shorts is a death game by all means. It's where I innocently ask my so-called friends to play Minecraft with me, but I subject them into my sick world full of death and agony. Like, I literally play the game with my own subjects, which is a spoiler, but I don't care. So the creators of Squid Game clearly ripped me off by stealing my copyrighted squid aesthetic, look at me right now, and general death game structure of Minecraft Shorts, and I'm sending my team of lawyers right now to sue them. Thank you. Enough of that garbage joke. I've just watched Squid Game because it had squid in the name and I'm chronically diagnosed with FOMO. More importantly, I'm a huge fan of the death game genre. I'm no stranger to death game shows from a variety of media, like Mirai Nikki, Fate, Conrad or Ryuki, Battle Game in 5 Seconds, Danganronpa, Bloody Battle for Dream Island. I'm also acquainted with a few K-dramas, Train to Busan, CJ7, and that one with a kindergarten teacher in a failing nursery, and she had heart problems and one of the kids' parents were abusive. I need to know the name of this one film, please. Squid Game. I was bored, I'm into the death game genre, everyone was talking about it, and I succumbed to social peer pressure. I love death games so much for quite a few reasons. Here they are. I'm going to list them right now. Number 1. Character drama. In death games, there's always character drama. The game every player is subjected to is the conflict itself, and every player has a different outlook on life or quirky personality. That contrasts everyone else, and I can always appreciate just the clashing of ideals between different parties. Like, it brings out the pros and negatives from both sides of a situation, personified as characters in the show, if you get my drift, and is applicable in real life. Really make you ponder who is right, who deserves to live, or have the right to do something. Also, eventually you'll grow attached to certain characters. Of course, they just die horrifically and gruesomely right in front of you. Second reason, it's always tense. Speaking of that, there's always something on the line at every moment in the show. There's a constant feeling of dread and terror when watching these death game shows, because even when not competing in some game, you never feel safe as you're still stuck in this rut filled with death and suffering. During the games, it's the special moment of anyone could die at any moment, and that's always fun. It keeps things engaging and exhilarating. Reason number 3. Innovative, weird-ass games. In every death game show I watched, there wasn't a single game that overlapped in any other game show. Every single obstacle for the players was something morbid and new and exciting and made me wonder, how the hell do they get out of that alive? Which naturally makes me want to watch how it ends. The reason why I watched Mirai Nikki when I was a dumb weeb at 12 years old, even though nowadays I'd call it a plot hole haven, the reason why I watched it was because it was something I'd never seen before. It was a completely new breath of fresh air. Every game was so cool and the characters ended up in the wackiest situations, like a school during a terrorist attack, their own household filled with gas, and a psychopath child chasing them, infiltrating like a shrine filled with zombies, then a super sentai shows up out of nowhere. Like, every time I was amazed at how creative these situations were. Building on top of that, reason 4 is their equally innovative solutions from players. Like, the creative situations were subjected to, creative solutions were needed as well, just giving a huge mind blow at how cool that 900 IQ chess move that was. Really, anything that resembles a JoJo fight in any way, I'm a fan of. You just have to be a complete, bizarre, eccentric, savant whackhead to think of the stuff to get out of a death game. Sometimes they go really in-depth in how every tiny move could influence winning or losing, and it makes me go into a different mindset of thinking how myself could get out of this, and then the players think of some last-second solution that always impresses me. Like, the strategizing is engaging as well, because it makes you think how a game could go down as well. It's great. Squid Game didn't disappoint me in any of these areas. The rest of this video will basically be a rundown of the show with personal anecdotes of mine sprinkled in. It's not really a review or an analysis, it's more of a scattered thoughts. I mean, I basically did what I wanted to do, I literally just wanted to make the joke at the beginning and that's it. To force it in right now, I'm just gonna use my Minecraft avatar to continue doing this video, you're welcome. Spoilers, obviously. If you don't want to watch the entire thing, at least watch the first episode before watching some 15-minute recap online. It's absolutely engaging enough to hook you in on the first episode, but even if you still don't want to watch the rest, the best episode is episode 6, the one with the marbles. After a change of heart, I realized the nitpicking details in every episode was incredibly boring, and I don't feel like editing all that, so I cut a majority of the original video's length. However, I decided to keep some parts of the original, especially the episode 6 review. It's real good. So think of the next section as an out-of-context compilation of the original, except that you will never experience the original. Thanks for understanding, and enjoy the video. Gihun is the most pathetic man possible, but he pushed this nice girl over, and he, like, desperately struggles to put this girl's straw back into the boba drink, and it's just so funny, I don't know why. Get called to a big court, and now we were called to play red light, green light. No one took it seriously. When the first man died, everyone lost their shit and tried to escape from the way they came. But yeah, it killed them all. Q, fly me to the moon. Big dick, Chad energy, Allie saves him. I thought at first, oh, they couldn't think of anything else to put here, so they just added pretentious classical music to people dying. But honestly, it was a good introductory game, setting up the feel of the following games, and even incorporating a bit of strategy. If the majority agrees, they could cancel the games, and to everyone's surprise, it was actually cancelled. I was surprised then, but then I realized it was a pretty smart way of adding exposition and making you care about the characters more before the actual games. He said, I don't care what you do with our deceased players, burn them, harvest their organs, eat them. What I care about is equality. You know, if those really were the ideals this game would be founded on, then I'm surprised he didn't just make a socialist state. Everyone was losing their marbles this episode. But seriously, this is hands down the best one. Everyone has to split to two teams, thinking they team up to fight other teams, but it turns out the two players have to fight against each other. It's a surprisingly open-ended game, you can play whatever marble game you want. In 30 minutes, the person who has all 20 marbles wins. This episode was pure characterization chemistry to the max, filled with betrayal and trickery, and then heartbreaking loss and despair. The main characters team up with other main characters, and you just know someone has to die from the either two, and it's torture knowing that. Like, not a single pair bored me. The thug one basically showed the tenseness of a normal participant's game. Ali's pure-heartedness versus Sangwoo's cunning, and the old man in Gihun's game, Gihun's just shouting, we have to play these marbles or else we're gonna die, is so emotional. The acting is so good, I'd say it's mostly in the face's expressions, which is really impressive. After Sangwoo almost breaking the rules after assaulting Ali's winning streak, he proposed that there really was a way for both of them to win. So he sent him on a mission to count the old and the young or something, and it made absolutely no sense because it was just a ruse for him to steal all of the marbles. I didn't know why Ali didn't just go up to him and question what he was doing under his jacket there, but I wasn't really in the moment or thinking right either, and didn't question what he was doing at that moment. Like, I was also clinging to the false hope that there actually was a way for both of them to win. But goddammit though, Ali didn't deserve to die. He was a pure man through and through, you bastard. Also, Sangwoo must have reworded this phrase. I'm gonna have to check in editing. Gihun's game is a simple story of starting on a high note, saying, "Hey, we're best buds, right?" And they pinky promise, and then the immediate heartbreak of knowing only one of you will survive. It's a simple, effective story of betrayal and taking advantage of the old man's deteriorating condition. Look at this man's face. Being so desperate to continuously take advantage of an old man's loss of hearing to survive. Even with that, I'm mostly affected by the Sangbyuk and Ji-young's relationship, which didn't have any betrayal. Like, it was just them talking to each other, and Sangbyuk reluctantly opening up. But my god, I don't know why this girl just has a way of making me teary-eyed, like, promising a girl's night out when they know that's impossible, saying, "Let me die in style," and that one tiny subtle hint of sadness when she died. This episode was the headcanon ending for me. I was emotionally fulfilled from the series after watching this moment. Honestly, the next episode, while still tense and exciting, wasn't as emotionally ripping as this one. Seriously watch this. I don't do any justice by spoiling it. Actually experiencing it will destroy you emotionally. The last episode. It's basically the last episode of Kamen Rider Kuga where they punch each other, yay. Whoa, where did D-Luke come from? He freaks out when he sees the slapping guy again, and now sets off to try to stop the Squid Game in Season 2. Or whatever. I'll be honest, I really don't think there should be any kind of continuation though. Seeing more players do Squid Game would be really fun, and there'd be a lot of B-plot of Gihun trying to stop it. Or maybe a prequel, seeing how that guy's brother winning the Squid Game in 2015 becoming the frontman. Even with all these possibilities, I'm satisfied with just watching this one piece. It's great and mostly contained without needing backstory or future continuations. The good thing is that there's still a large pool of children's games they could go through, so theoretically, they could just keep having more and more ideas for it. Like, you'd never get bored of the, "Oh, I get it, it's a dark, bloody turn on a children's game," because of all the entertaining strategies they come up with. Tests different attributes, like, the first one was just a physical test, like running and reaction time. Not really smarts, which is why they filled it in with music. The second one, Sugar Honeycomb, was dexterity and sleight of hand. And the marble game showed the depravity humans were willing to go through with betrayal and such. Each and every having different stakes and vastly different strategies to win. It's incredibly engaging and fun and tense and exciting, but I don't think it necessarily has like a defining point, like a main message it wants to say about society or human behavior. It could absolutely have some moral if you dig into it, like, whoa, maybe the VIP guests are like the audience surrogate, and we were really as bad as the VIP guests who are just as entertained as they are. You know, I'm not a guy who'd grasp at strings to find some sort of point from a piece of media. Experientially speaking, it's a roller coaster ride. I'd say Squid Game is just an incredibly compelling piece of drama if you're into seeing characters you love suffer constantly and inevitably die.